The recently departed Seiko SKX was really the quintessential tool watch. And while I never owned one, I do think I understand what gave it such an iconic place in the horological world. You see, not only was it a unique, very distinguished design, but it also just seemed to hit that sweet spot in terms of size, comfort, durability, and most importantly, affordability. So it's no wonder that Seiko didn't want to fully kill off the SKX legacy, but instead decided to, well, kind of cash in by creating a whole line of Seiko 5 doppelgangers. And this introduction has been met with a whole lot of controversy and a lot of discussion that seems to span the entire horological interwebs, as these new watches aren't true divers like the SKX was, but rather dive style watches. So I think it does need to be said that while they do resemble the SKX, and in many ways they do inherit its legacy, they aren't it. And in many ways they should be judged for better or worse on their own merits. Now, I believe these were released last month, so availability is still pretty scarce out there. But I was able to buy this Pepsi version from Gnomon. And what I didn't realize at the time is that this specific model is a JDM release, hence the made in Japan at the bottom of the dial. But we have a lot to cover here, and I do think there's a lot of interest in these new watches, so I think it's best if we just jump right in and start to take a look at the case. The case is of course stainless, and I think it's almost identical to its predecessor, except for the addition of an exhibition case back and drilled lugs. The drilled lugs I think are a very welcome addition, while the case back, well, it's not a real diver, so it doesn't really matter anyways. But it's there for those that really love to see the movement. Width is 42mm wide without the crown, and width it's more like 44.6. And those slightly stubby curved lugs lead to a shorter lug to lug of 46mm. And they just have this very nice rounded organic curve to them as they flow down, which I think leads to a very nice comfortable fit for most people. It's 13.5mm thick, which I think is rather average these days for divers. But then again, this isn't a real diver with only 100 meters of water resistance. And that right there is going to be a sticking point for some, but it is in line with what other Seiko 5 dive style watches are, and especially the ones I've looked at, such as the bottle cap and the ice monster. And to be blunt, well, 100 meters is all anyone really needs. While the SKX was a quintessential dive watch, remember, it's also the quintessential desk diver. And the 5KX here also retains those 22mm lugs, so all your old dive straps should fit it. Although I have heard that the location of the spring bars has changed from the SKX, so most of the SKX aftermarket bracelets won't fit this without some sort of adapter. Weight-wise, we have about 160 grams here, so it just really feels like a nice solid watch. Price is going to be the major sticking point here, with an MSRP of $295. And right now, they're selling for that, and sometimes higher. But I think as availability increases, I do expect that to drop. But we'll just have to wait and see. And I'll talk more about the price at the end, because that is a big issue here. The finishing is good, and really what you'd expect on a Seiko. Everything is nice and rounded, and no sharp edges are found anywhere. The top and bottom are brushed, while the sides are polished. And the case has a circular brushing, where the folded end links are more vertical. So I think that really creates a nice two-tone effect where the two finishes meet. And I also just really love those angled edges of the crown guard, as they also retain the polished finish of the sides. Overall, I think the case design is rather simple and compact, but it just has this touch of refined quality to it, as it retains these very nice organic curves, which are highlighted nicely by the beveled polished edge where the two finishes meet. Now, in line with its predecessor, the crown is at the 4 o'clock position, and it is tucked nicely into those crown guards. And the crown is really my first complaint here, and the first issue I have is that it's not signed, which is kind of a disappointment on its own at this price level, but that's not really my big issue with it. Now, since this isn't a real diver, it doesn't have a screw-down crown. It's more of your normal push-pull type crown, which again, by itself, I don't have an issue with. It's not an issue I had with, say, the bottle cap. But here, this case design was really designed for a screw-down crown, and the crown was made to unscrew and come out further beyond the crown guard so you can easily use it. Where here, even when it's pulled out, it's still partially guarded by them, So I don't think it really extends enough as it needs to, and just makes manipulating it just a little more difficult than it really needs to be. Overall, I think it's a minor issue, and perhaps it's a worthy trade-off for getting the newer 4R36 movement, rather than, say, the 7S26 that was in the SKX, or some of the older Seiko 5s. Which, of course, brings us to the bezel. And it is a very nice coin-edge bezel with a Pepsi aluminum insert. And as this is a Seiko, one would have very high hopes for that bezel. But unfortunately, I honestly have to tell you that this is by far the worst bezel I've ever run across. And to be fair, it is most likely that I got a dud. But we still have to talk about it. The bezel is supposed to be 120 click and unidirectional, but this one is more like 60.5-ish. It suffers from what I've heard some refer to as a click and sub-click, where while you're turning it, you do feel one really good click, but then it's followed by this sort of half-click, and that half-click is on the full second mark. Worse yet is on that full second mark, if you try to rotate it back, you do feel just a small amount of resistance, but then it pops back completely, so it doesn't lock it in place. Although on the half click, it does fully lock it in place, and at that point, it really doesn't have much back play. Now, I freely admit that this is most likely a dud, and should be atypical of what you would normally expect, but I did contact Gnomon about it and showed them a video of what was going on. And they of course apologized, but they also said that they thought Seiko would still consider it to be within spec, and that it was still better than a couple they actually had to send back to Japan, as they weren't quite as consistent as this one. So interpret that as you will. They also offered to let me exchange it or to keep it and get a small discount. And I chose to get a discount in this case and then show it to you guys, as this really is a real-world example of what you might actually get. Now, for those that know what they're doing, I'm betting this is a pretty easy fix. But when you combine that with the misaligned chaptering on the dial, I think it just goes to show that Seiko's QC issues are very much alive and well, even on one that supposedly is made in Japan. One of the best things about this new Seiko 5 lineup is just the wide variety of dial colors and textures. But when I was choosing one, I opted to go with just the classic blue sunburst. And it's just a beautiful dark blue, and I think it looks brilliant against the metallic framed white indices. And in following with the SKX, the indices here are primarily dots, with just this oversized triangle at the 12, and these more oval shapes at the 6 and 9. And all three of those indices have an extended metallic point out that just leads your eyes towards the center of the dial. Now, the 3, we have a day and date complication, which completely replaced the indice. And as this is a JDM model, it does have kanji script. And looking at the top of the dial, and debuting for the first time, we have the new Seiko 5 logo. And it's somewhere in between a snake or, say, a Superman logo. Personally, I rather like it, and I do think it's a needed update to the Seiko 5 line. The new logo is simple, yet very recognizable. And I think it just adds a little bit of needed character to the dial. The handset here is very much in line with the SKX, with this shorter pencil-like hour hand and an oversized minute, along with the stick second hand with a lollipop counterweight on the back. Overall, I think it's a good-looking dial design, and one that's rather effective and actually proven itself over the years. That deep blue dial just contrasts nicely with the white indices, and is just really clearly visible and easy to read. Well, I think the sunburst effect of the dial just teams up nicely with the reflective edges of the indices, as they play beautifully with the light. It's just a classic and beautiful looking design, although it would look a little bit better with a lined up chapter ring. Now, as this is a Seiko, you would expect it to have some pretty good lume, as it would use Seiko's proprietary Lumabrite. And to test it, I threw it up against a Turtle and the Seiko Ice Monster, as well as a Helm Komodo just for good measure. And the results were a little bit interesting, as after about an hour, the hands actually faded just a little bit more than those other two Seikos, while the dial remained just as strong. But overall, I'd say it's in line with those other two Seikos, so it's good lume and definitely worthy of the name Seiko. Movement-wise, we have the 4R36, and it pretty much gives you everything you need. It's a standard beat rate, hacking, and most importantly, hand winding, something the SKX couldn't do. And accuracy was actually fairly impressive on this one. You usually have bad luck with Seikos, but here I was only losing about a second a day. So I'm not sure if that's a fluke or if they're actually doing some fine tuning of these in Japan, but it's good to see regardless. And finally, we get to the bracelet, and it's pretty much what you'd expect for a Seiko 5. It's decent and a fairly comfortable oyster-style bracelet. There's no tapering to it, so it does stay 22mm all around, and it does have your standard folded end links and a rather good but stamped clasp. So overall, I'd say the bracelet is good, but not too good. And it wears, well, like you'd expect. It's just overall well-rounded and comfortable, which is probably one of the greatest strengths of the design here, and one of the biggest reasons the SKX was so loved. It has this great presence to it, but at the same time it's rather comfortable to wear. And just like its predecessors, you can throw it on a variety of other straps and NATOs, which again is greatly helped by having those drilled lugs. So for just a moment, let's ignore the QC issues. And at that point, the only issue I really have is that the crown is kind of hard to manipulate with that case design. And if that's my only real complaint, then I would have to say that this is an excellent, well-rounded, entry-level automatic watch. And I think it would make a great addition to the Seiko 5 lineup, when the price actually falls in line with the rest of those Seiko 5s, which is usually well under $200. Right now, there's just no way to really justify what these are currently going for. I mean, for the same price, you could actually get a real Seiko diver, like say a Turtle or a Samurai. And if you look at Orient, you could pick up a Kamasu for the same price. And if you're lucky and happen to find one on sale, you could get a Triton. Not to mention a whole slew of microbrands that are really giving you a lot more bang for your buck than you're getting here. And when you consider Seiko's QC issues these days, maybe that's really where your money should be going. So if you're really in love with some of these, especially the more interesting versions, my advice would be to hold off until the prices become much more reasonable. Right now, the only ones who should be buying this are either the diehard Seiko fans or reviewers like myself who want to be the first to show one of these off. So basically, let us waste our money first and then give you an idea of what's going on. As for myself, I really don't know what I'm going to do with this. I'm not sure if I want to keep it or sell it, or heck, even mod it just to see if some of the aftermarket SKX parts will fit it. But until I figure that out, let me know in a comment what you think about the 5KX, or just what do you think about Seiko's QC issues these days? Is it time to give up on them, or just stay with the faithful? And as always, if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks for watching.